Thank you, Mary Lee. Those songs come under the category, I think, of patriotic songs, but there's an awful lot of hymns. Those songs that are moving. Also, music. It's time for call to worship, everybody, you stand. The realm of God has come near. Enter this time of worship with joyous expectation.
We will extol you, God, for you have drawn us up. You have rescued us from the pit and restored us to life.
Sing praises to God, O faithful ones. Give thanks to God's holy name.
We have known your favor, O God, many ways. You have healed us and turned our mourning into dance.
Rejoice in the work you are given to do. Give thanks that your names are known to God.
We will praise you, O God, and not be silent. We will give thanks to you forever.
Amen to that. Join me in our prayer. Loving God, you sent us out to bear witness to the coming of your kingdom. Help us to trust that you will provide us what we need as we worship and serve you. This we pray through Jesus our Savior. Amen. 398. Make purses for yourselves that do wear out, a an unfailing treasure in heaven where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. But where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Offer place at the center of the sanctuary and at the entry door. Father God, we're indeed thankful to you for this place. We're indeed thankful to you for this day. We're thankful to you for the day we'll celebrate tomorrow with our independence, for our society, for our country, where we live. We're indeed thankful to you for the ability to be able to place offerings in the offering place. At this time, we give you thanks. Those who have given, we give you thanks for the gifts. We give you thanks for the wisdom to be able to use them properly. We ask this in your precious name. Children's message time, Mary.
Keep able to see what I'm going to do. And I'm sorry. So again, I apologize. It's not an excursion. So I decided I would just talk about I was talking so. What is this? It's bad, yeah. going to conceal, but it's a little lady is knitting, just knitting needle, and she can walk. I know the extremes, she can walk. So I can do like this, use my muscles. Do you see all the things she's doing? Who's making her move like that? How is she moving? If I just do nothing, is she? She has like that if I use the strength, right? Oh. She's got her hands above her eyes and she can move. That's what she's doing. That's funny. But she can't do anything unless my hand. I must lose her, right? Can she do anything if I don't do this? What can she do? She just sits there. What makes her move? I have to hold her with my hand, right? I have to do it with my strings, right? But how does Evelyn move? What makes Evelyn move? What makes Mary move? Do we have strengths? Do you have strengths? Where's your strength? Do I have strengths? I do this. I have strength, or can I just do it because I have strength? Do I have strength about this puppet? No. Do you have strength about this puppet? No. You have stuffed animals? I know. We don't want them very pets. We've got this in the antique store. This actually belongs to pets. This is pets. But you can't move this marionette without our own hands, right? And so here's what I was looking at. God is faithful. This is 1 Corinthians, verse 13. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Is it possible that sometimes we do things that we shouldn't do? No. Is it possible that sometimes if somebody says, don't put your hand in the dirt because you just did that? Do you put your hand in the dirt sometimes anyway? You know, so you decide to do that, right? You didn't have anybody moving your strings or moving your hand to do something that wasn't supposed to do. You decided to do that. That's called, it's a big word, temptation. Can you say temptation? Temptation. That means we want to do something so bad that we don't worry about what happens if we do it. Now, that one. We don't have to do things if we know we're not supposed to. Look at my face. We don't have to get a cookie from God, says my cookie. We don't have to stomp our feet. Says, don't stomp your feet. We can decide. We're not puppets. We can decide. So God gives us strength to do that. We're going to be good, right? Can you do that? Okay. That's great. And I'm dancing this hard. I'm going to pray about it. And I'm going to say, I'm going to do my best. I'm going to do my best. Okay, let's have a prayer. Ready? God, thank you for Evelyn and her life and her family that helps her to stay out of the temptation's way. Remind us that you are not controlling our actions and what we are doing by focus on strength, we are able to be tempted and bear that temptation, knowing that we trust you and do what you would have us to do. We will always choose the right thing in your name.
our scripture this morning. Chapter 10 of Luke. Reading Colossians at home this morning, and Paul's letter to the church of Colossae, he refers to Luke, stop to Luke. We'll see that a lot. Scripture today is from Dr. Luke, chapter 10. And I'm using the big print Bible, so I'm sorry I can't tell you what page it's on, but it's Luke 10. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.' And if anyone is there who shares the peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off and protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, on that day, it will be more tolerable for Sodom than for that town.'" Interesting words. Look forward to hearing Dad discuss that. Just now I asked Master's Road Band to come forth and bring us worship and music. Thank you.
Loving God, as we gather in this place, called as bearers of your message, who accepted your hospitality and entered your house. Help us, mighty God, to hear your instructions and to open ourselves to bearing your message to those around us. These things we pray in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Through all of the travel that I have done over the years, I must confess that one thing that I have never really been accused of is traveling light. That is to say that I'm one of those people who insists on packing a hooded sweatshirt with me in the hottest months of the summer, on the off chance that it might get cold outside. And someone will throw a pair of athletic shorts into my bag, even if I'm going on a ski trip in the middle of January, because I might get hot around the room that I'm staying. While cliches generally display some wisdom, I am one of those persons who, shall we say, takes the old axiom that failure to prepare is preparing to fail a bit beyond its logical conclusion. And while I believe that I personally stopped just short of taking the kitchen sink with me when I travel, I suspect that there are many others who are hearing this sermon who can resonate with that desire to be prepared, especially when one is going away from home. It has taken some time, but I have finally come around to leaving the extra layers of shoes behind when I'm going for a quick trip But let's just say that I don't expect to be missing anything next week. Fair enough. Beyond what we pack when we travel, I suspect that most of us also want to have a detailed plan about where we are going and what we are doing when we travel. For evidence of me taking that over the top, please see Sister Tabitha after worship service. If the trip is going to take longer than a day, do we have reservations for where we will stay along the way? Do we know where we want to stop and eat and how much we expect to spend in doing so? And what do we plan to do whenever we get to wherever it is that we happen to be going? These are the types of plans that many of us make whenever we travel, whether for business or for pleasure. With all of this in mind, it seems very strange to me, and I feel very challenged personally by the story of Jesus selecting the 70 and sending them out two by two. It seems strange to me that Jesus did not concern himself with any of these sorts of cares that I spend entirely too much time on when I get ready to travel. Luke tells us that when Jesus selected these additional disciples, he sent them ahead of him in pairs as sort of an advanced party for the places that he intended to visit. Consider this a bit larger version of Jesus sending the messengers to the Samaritan village at the end of chapter 9. But even with this in mind, Jesus did not seem particularly systematic in his approach to where he was sending these messengers or in giving them their marching orders. In place of what most of us would have as a tremendous concern about where, Jesus instead spends his instructional time on how these 70 persons are to complete the mission that he has set before them. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs in the midst of wolves." Before he gets to the nitty-gritty, Jesus wants these 70 individuals to know what they are getting themselves into. This will not be an easy mission, and those who can potentially harm them and their mission will be all around them. But with that acknowledgement, it seems interesting to me that Jesus commands them to forego the usual preparations. He instructs those that he is sending to carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and to greet no one on the road. Considering the challenge of opposition, the limits of travel in the ancient world, and a whole host of other potential concerns, why in the world would Jesus do this? Why would Jesus tell them, go on your way, but make sure that you don't do anything that might resemble physical preparation for your journey? Was this merely about trusting that God would provide? Or was there some practical reason for these instructions? I suspect that much of this was about the vulnerability of depending on God and the necessity of accepting hospitality. But there is another potential reason that Jesus gives his counsel. Often throughout the Gospels, Jesus warned of the way that possessions and the need to protect and secure them get in the way of seeking first the kingdom of God. And there is a way that those possessions that we we might take with us on our travels might be an additional hindrance beyond the load carrier. Most bandits do not assault travelers for the fun or thrill of beating someone up. They expect to be able to steal items of value from those who are passing by. And so if you aren't carrying anything that appears to have earthly value, there's a bit less incentive for a bandit, a thief, or other dangerous person to have much of anything to do with you. The commands from Jesus to speak to no one on the road also communicates the urgency of the mission. This could very easily be paraphrased as Jesus saying in 7, take care that you do not do anything or say anything that will get you sidetracked or distracted. Traveling light removes the need for additional security during the trip, while also removing the temptation to provide for oneself. And so with that ability removed, Jesus instructed his messengers about how they were to deal with their physical needs. He told them to extend their peace to whatever household would receive them, and to remain within the first household to welcome them, eating and drinking what was put before them. During the time of Jesus, hospitality had not yet developed into an industry, and especially in the small villages that Jesus and the 70 were traveling through, hospitality was a person-to-person interaction. Travelers would need to seek shelter wherever it was offered, without the security of knowing that there was an ancient Holiday Inn or Super 8 hotel that would put you up for the night and serve you breakfast in exchange for your hard-earned money. Jesus' command to expect hospitality goes beyond the necessities brought about by the limitations of travel at this time. How often, sisters and brothers, is our ability to connect with neighbors, co-workers, and others in sharing the good news of Christ inhibited by the mistaken notion that those others that we might want to connect to have nothing to offer to us? In demanding vulnerability to those who carry his message, Jesus was emphasizing the importance of building genuine relationships where his followers would necessarily depend upon those that they were administering with. Without the vulnerability of accepting hospitality, without the vulnerability of relationships, there was no mission. To truly welcome others in the name of Jesus, we have to see beyond our comfort zone, our desire for complete safety and security, and be willing to be vulnerable, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Jesus continued by instructing his messengers that accepting hospitality and the vulnerability that comes with it was but the first step to their mission. If they found persons in a village receptive, they were to heal the sick there and to announce that the kingdom of God had drawn near. For all of the singularity and purpose, Jesus tells those that he is sending not once but twice to seek the leave and welcome of the household and village that they were entering before they started healing and preaching. I wonder if that is one of the problems that comes with much of what passes for evangelism in the modern world, both locally and globally. Too many would-be modern evangelists get this way of Jesus backwards. Too many of us want to heal, save, and preach before getting to know the people and communities that that we are with. And too many of us are convinced that those around us, particularly those who do not yet know Jesus, have nothing to offer to us. To really latch on to something, particularly to something new, folks need to feel needed. They need to feel that they are contributing. They need to, as the phrase goes, have some skin in the game. In demanding that his messengers accept hospitality, Jesus was both ensuring that they form relationships before seeking to heal and preach, and he was also giving the recipients of their message a sense of belonging and a sense of contribution to the mission that was taking place. The thing about vulnerability is that it requires giving up control. Now, there are a lot of words that we can use to describe our Lord and Savior. Nowhere in Scripture do I find naive to be one of them. And so I don't believe that Jesus was naive to the potential consequences of giving up control. In fact, he was quite well aware that one of the potential consequences, the cross that awaited him at the end of the journey, was a direct result of him choosing to give up control. And so, when providing instructions to these 70 disciples, he first spoke about what to do with a positive response. But Jesus eventually got around to the fact that not everyone will respond positively to their mission. And so Jesus teaches them how to conduct themselves with a household or village who do not receive them. Unlike what James and John wanted to do in the previous chapter, Jesus tells the 70 that when you are not received, don't go make a scene. Don't demand your right to be heard. Don't fuss and fume, do you know who I am? But instead, he said to them, whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into the streets and say, even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off and protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. The vulnerability of seeking and expecting hospitality has built into it the risk rejection. And even if there are certain social expectations which might vary somewhat by culture, there is always a choice on the part of the one who may or may not receive the messenger. Jesus wants us to be prepared to bear his message, whether in the ancient or modern world, means that some will reject the message that we bear. This instruction makes it clear that the appropriate response for a disciple to this type of rejection is to let go and to trust that God will deal with the fallout. Luke does not tell us in the subsequent verses about the success rate of the 70 whom Jesus sent out. He doesn't report the names of the villages that they went to, how long they stayed, or if they were able to actually prepare the way for Jesus. We don't know how many of the villages that Jesus intended to get to that actually arrived. What we do know is that when the 70 returned to Jesus, they were feeling encouraged by what they had seen, heard, and anticipated. I believe that this lack of knowledge, this lack of record of their success is deliberate on the part of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit's way of telling generations of Christians to follow that when it comes to the task of sharing our faith, faithfulness is in our hands. The results are in God's hands. It is a way of God encouraging us to let go of seeking quick results, to let go of the fear of rejection and vulnerability, and to let go of the need always provide for ourselves. Instead of focusing on the results, Jesus responded to those who came back. I watched Satan fall from heaven, like a flash light. More important than the results, more important than the number of persons saved, more important than the amount of people in the church or the survival of the church as an institution, is the power of God. And just as Jesus said when he told his disciples that they should testify that the kingdom of God had come near, whether they were welcome or not, we as modern Christians need to accept that whether we are successful or failures in a worldly sense, whether we feel strong or feel vulnerable in a moment, whether we are accepted or rejected, that none of those things, none of those circumstances negate the truthfulness of the gospel or the power of God found in our Lord Jesus. In these 10 verses, the kingdom of God had come near, whether the village accepted or rejected the messengers. And likewise, the reign of God has come near to us, no matter what we see all around us. So where, brothers and sisters, does that leave us? What is God calling us to take with us from these instructions that Jesus gave to these 70 followers all those years ago? I believe that two things stand out as the most important from this scripture passage. The first is that the types of genuine relationships that lead to the true and genuine sharing of the gospel require patience and vulnerability. Like Jesus' first followers, we too are called to be patient and to be vulnerable, depending on the hospitality of others and extending our own hospitality in mission. For the gospel to truly take root in the life of someone else, we have to be willing not only to give to that someone else, but also to receive from them. The invitation into community requires the full give and take of the community. Mission is not something that we who already know Christ do for someone else. It is something that we who already know Christ do in partnership with those around us, inviting persons into a deep and genuine faith in our Lord Jesus, a faith that they will both receive from and give to. Second, I hear a strong call in this passage to focus less on results and more on faithfulness. And I must confess, brothers and sisters, that the mathematical part of my brain has a hard time with that. Like many of you, I'm also a results-oriented person. I want to see progress. I want to see growth. And I want to see it yesterday. And I suspect that many of you do, too. Our God has a different sense of time than many of us do. And God's power and God's presence is not measured in worldly terms. If we truly trust the power of God, if we truly believe the message of our Lord Jesus, let us then seek the hospitality of others, their partnership in our ministry and mission, and share the message of Jesus without fear of failure. For the call to share is ours to do. The results are God's. As we continue in response to the work of our Lord God, let us stand together and sing hymn number 478, sent forth by God's grace. Results are in Christ's hands. Amen. Go in peace.